I welcome you all to the Christian Half Hour program conducted by the National Christian Council of Sri Lanka. I am Reverend Jude Sudarshan Mahendran, who is a priest attached to Church of the American Ceylon Mission. I mostly worked in the northern province in Sri Lanka. Today I have selected a topic to talk on this program is Peacebuilding from Christian perspective. I have gone through ample experience with secular, other religious, Christian peacebuilding organizations and interreligious peacebuilding organizations. After gaining the experience from all these different approaches of these different organizations, I tried to resonate what is real, sustainable, true reconciliation is. I have seen a lot of different kinds of reconciliation, a forcible reconciliation on victims, bogus reconciliation, shallow reconciliation, and some sort of reconciliation without dealing with the past but just focusing on future. So after seeing all these things, different kinds of reconciliation, I started to think from a Christian perspective, what is reconciliation like from the perspective of Christianity and its resources like Bible. So here I am going to present a talk on the topic of peace building from Christian perspective. I welcome you all to listen to my talk. Peacebuilding from Christian perspective. St. Paul says, reconciliation is communion with God. We can also call it as salvation or justification, new creation, etc. Paul uses different words to explain salvation, what salvation is. So Christians, we always think that reconciliation is human reconciling with God. Or we think a sinner repents to God. It is one side of reconciliation. We call it vertical reconciliation. There is another side, horizontal reconciliation. This calls for reconciliation among human beings, either individually or socially. The Bible very clearly expresses that reconciliation should bring the both sides, horizontal and vertical, which is the holistic reconciliation, what God wants us to do. If we read 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verses 17 to 20, we have become new creation through Jesus Christ, who reconciled us to God. He has also given the ministry of reconciliation in our hands. So we are, as ambassadors of Christ, must engage in the reconciliation work. If we go through Ephesians chapter 2 verses 12 to 15, it says, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, we have overcome the dividing walls and hostility between humans. God has reconciled divided groups in one body through the cross. So therefore, no one is stranger or alien hereafter, but all are the members of the one household of God. Therefore, we Christians should remember that the new creation or salvation that includes reconciliation with God and fellow human beings. When we look at the cross, we can remember this idea that in cross we have two lines. One is vertical, one is horizontal. When we see the vertical, we should remember, okay, that's my reconciliation with God. And when we see the horizontal line, we should remember the inevitable, the second part of reconciliation, that is reconciliation among fellow human beings. There are some principles in Christian peace building I have adopted from various Christian authors and Bible. Number one is, God is the author of reconciliation. We participate in the work of God. We should remember and listen to God's ways, approaches, importance given in reconciliation work, which may be sometimes beyond our human comprehension. Therefore, we should learn to wait on God in prayer, and that waiting will enhance us, our capacity to listen and to discern small, barely noticeable moments in the process of healing. Healing is a very important component in the practices of reconciliation. The second principle is, in reconciliation, God begins with the victim. In liberation theology, there is a famous saying that God's preferential option for the poor or for the victim. I am not bringing liberation theology here, but it is the well-recognized Christian principle in peace building that God begins reconciliation work with the victim. We see this approach from the Old Testament prophets and Jesus Christ. This victim's first approach is used to find ways where victims could find healing after a time of conflict, oppression, and systemic violence. Wrongdoers seldom or ever apologize or take responsibility for their atrocities. In the context of Sri Lankan ethnic conflict, and especially during the war, so much of crimes against humanity were conducted. Relations of the family members who were forcibly made to disappear are demanding for justice and truth-telling on streets more than 1,000 days. But there is no truth-telling or apology for these mass crimes. The political climate in Sri Lanka is also supporting the wrongdoers who enjoy impunity. So within the culture of impunity, they claim themselves as saviors of the nation. So the climate of Sri Lanka is not supporting the victims to come out from their situation. The crucial part is, victims have to wait for an apology or for justice to be done before they can begin to heal. They are held to hostage to the past indefinitely and sometimes forever. God does not suspend the cry of victims for justice, but God always finds ways for healing to begin. So since we engage in reconciliation work as Christian ministers, as Christian ministries, we should always think that how we give importance to victims in our work, how we start the work of reconciliation with the victims. If there is not healing and eventually some measure of justice for victims, a culture of peace will be a dream beyond our reach as people live with unhealed wounds. Therefore, the victim's first approach is dealing with to restore the humanity of victims that has been denied for so long. The purpose of victim's first approach is to restore them in the communion of God. When victims begin to realize the presence of God as a healing power, it will be important for victims' future. Further, Christians must work not only doing relief and charity to victims, but also work steadily on addressing the causes of victimization. Therefore, without focusing on victims, there won't be a true reconciliation. My third principle is, in reconciliation, God makes of victim and the wrongdoer a new creation. In reconciliation work, we do not abandon wrongdoers. It is very important to take care of wrongdoers. By engaging in wrongdoing, wrongdoer has lost some measure of humanity. Or the wrongdoer might have a broken humanity. through practices of conversion, remorse, acts of realization, through punishment or rituals, perpetrators' humanity should be restored. They should be restored back in their human society. So God's reconciliation work does not take us to the previous status before the crime happened. It takes us to a new place. We become new creation. People who have been displaced more than 30 years from Jaffna Peninsula could not go back to their places since the high security zones are maintained. But people who could go to their places could not find out their homes or even the landmarks of their places when they return after 30 years. So therefore, the resettling of a refugee is so difficult. If exiles, displacements have been away for many years, they find their homelands so changed by intervening events that they no longer feel comfortable there. Some feel that they can't go home. In instances like torture or mutilation or loss or disappearance of a loved one, there can be no return to the past. The only way is forward. The practices of healing must accompany the victims in their path of healing. These may entail physical healing or overcoming the effects of trauma, and it may involve the healing of memories. So we cannot simply say that we can be restored to the normal past. Sometimes we have to envision a new creation, a new place, and God is making us new creation. The moment of new creation is an amazing moment. There is a wonderful experience after a long conflict history. The South Africa became a new creation in the early 1990s. The South Africa could move from the decades of state violence to its rainbow society without further violence and killings. That is one of those amazing moments. Our God is a merciful God. God will help us to leave the painful past at some point and helps us to move into a new future by making us new creation. The fourth principle I like to say, Christians place their suffering in the story of suffering of Christ. We should look into suffering, the nature of suffering. Suffering in itself is destructive to human spirit and can lead to disintegration of human person. It seems suffering can be overcome or even positively transformed only if it can be situated in or attached to some cause or reality larger than the personal suffering. Tamils accepted all their suffering in the hope of their liberation from the oppression. But when all these collapsed at the end of war, they lost the meaning. They felt the emptiness. So this kind of some of these attributions to something larger can lead to passivity, such as believing that it is my lot to suffer or that God has willed this suffering. For Christians, placing our suffering in the story of the suffering and death of Jesus Christ is a way of making suffering a means of forging something better and stronger than was there before. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 10 and 11, Paul says that he wishes to be patterned into the suffering of Christ in his own life so that he may come to know the power of the resurrection. Christ's suffering and death are considered by Christians to be something he did not deserve, and that God has recognized, that is raising Jesus from the dead. It is the promise that the resurrection sets before those who are faithful to Christ that prompts them to unite their suffering to Christ's in the hopes of experiencing the resurrection. This transformation, inspired by Paschal mystery, when I say Paschal mystery, I mean the suffering and death of Jesus Christ. This transformation, inspired by the Paschal mystery, helps Christians to go through the paradigm of the process of reconciliation by making meaning to their sufferings. Therefore, in the practices of reconciliation, we find a way through suffering to reconstruct the meaning that have been torn apart by traumatic experience. The victims must reconnect the meaning with self, their place in community, in the world, and even in God. Thus, the grand narrative of Jesus' betrayal, humiliation, rejection, torture, and death become the sites or the stations of cross where those experiences of victims can be placed. The hope is that a new narrative will emerge out of the narrative of our own suffering, that destructive memories will become redemptive ones then, that can help us to maintain humanity even under inhumane conditions. My fifth point is, the ultimate reconciliation is a cosmic event, is an eschatological event. If I explain that, a complete reconciliation will happen only when all people and all things have been reconciled in Christ at the end of time. I repeat that, a complete reconciliation will happen only when all people and all things have been reconciled in Christ at the end of time. You can refer Ephesians chapter 1 verse 10 and Colossians chapter 1 verse 20. We can take the example of transitional justice and the reconstruction of the society after war in Sri Lanka. We can clearly say that we could not repair the past, and even we could not do much for a better future, even after 12 years passed by, after the end of war. The need for healing is overwhelming. In the process of reconciliation, what we experience is lot of mess, twists, turns, reversals, setbacks, etc., etc. It looks that we cannot control the reconciliation process as we wish. However, let's have hope and optimism by saying that God gently changes things, because God fulfills the reconciliation, the complete reconciliation, at the end of time. So these are my principles that I want to share with my fellow friends, to resonate with these ideas that how the ministry of reconciliation is carried out. Is it really sustainable? Is that just reconciliation? Is that a serious reconciliation? So I hope these ideas, principles, would help us to evaluate our own ministry of reconciliation. Our dear Lord, thank you very much for giving us this time to reflect on peace building from Christian perspective. Dear Lord, thank you very much for giving us proper guidance through your Bible, through your prophets, through your Son Jesus Christ. What is reconciliation is? Dear Lord, we have seen that reconciliation is that we reconcile with you, and as well as we reconcile with our fellow human beings. The salvation cannot be accomplished without doing these two kinds of reconciliation. Dear Lord, thank you very much for teaching us that you are the author of reconciliation, and you are inviting us to take part in your mission. So whatever we do, you are responsible and you are before us in the ministry of reconciliation. Dear Lord, thank you very much for giving us the greatest noble ethics of starting reconciliation with the victims. Dear Lord, help us to sympathize with victims and help them to start a healing process as soon as possible. Dear Lord, thank you very much for making us aware that through the reconciliation process, you make the victim and wrongdoer a new creation. Thank you very much for giving us this new idea that, dear Lord, allow, enhance us to work this way, to accommodate victims and the wrongdoers together in our making new creations towards the work of reconciliation in our country. Dear Lord, we know that reconciliation is your work and is a cosmic event, and a complete reconciliation will complete in the eschatological time, the end of the time. However, even though we know that we cannot see a complete reconciliation in our lifetime, we still have the hope, we still live with the optimism that we can contribute our best for the reconciliation of our country. Help us to do the ministry that you have entrusted on us. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Thank you for listening to our program. This program is brought to you by National Christian Council of Sri Lanka. Please share your valuable feedback and comments about this program to this number 0112-671-723. 0112-671-723. Thank you and God bless you.